Thank you very much all. So I just wanted to start off really with your sort of reactions to what you've seen and heard this morning from our three different presenters. Don't mind which order you go in. Alex, do you want to start off?
Okay. I think it's lovely to see people talking about the balancing point. It's something that's come across very, very strongly in all of the presentations, all of the findings, this idea that you can find an optimal balance between print and digital, between online and offline channels, and in the channel mix. And I think it's refreshing in an environment where we're so used to hearing about one beating the other. So those of you who pay attention to the world of TV as well as print will know the increasingly infamous YouTube think box fight that definitely wasn't a fight about which channel has the best ROI, which is, I think, kind of misleading, slightly unhelpful, a little bit depressing for those of us in the industry who are having to make these kind of balancing point decisions. And so it's very refreshing to be seeing people talking about how you make these things work together, how you find that point between them all.
Yeah, I was definitely keen that we didn't go into my ROI is bigger than yours debate, because it's just not helpful. And I, if I'd listened to that as an agency, I would have been very cynical.
I think building on that, I was struck when I arrived this morning and you were talking about moving from data to models. And I've discovered coming back into an agency how sliced everything is these days, where I've got a PPC expert, an SEO expert, a display expert. And what's really made me start thinking about today is planning in the round. And all the data that's been shown is very much about layering channels on top of each other to get the best result for your client. And so I think we need to get ourselves back into that habit of thinking in the round, planning in the round, layering our campaigns, and then, as you said, analysing in the round, you know, the move to models, and to be able to hold that campaign together, to be able to tell the client both the individual elements, how they're working, but how the sum of the parts is stronger. And so it's really, you know, your cake, although I hate cherries on top, because I always feel that clients want to get rid of the cherry on top. They always come back and say, we don't do that one. But the layering and the thinking and the quality of our planning needs to come back together. And so we have all the experts, they're a little bit separate, but I think what we need to do is start bringing ourselves together to have more rounded debates.
I was really struck throughout all the presentations by the finding that press and news brands have a longer term effect. And as someone that's been doing econometrics for many years, and I think others who have done the same job as me would agree, we look at the length of effects of different types of media, and it's not that surprising to hear that press has a longer term effect, and typically a longer term effect than digital, in fact. So it was really interesting to see that, something which I've seen in my work over the years, reflected in the presentations here.
Yeah, that is that's one of the multitude of other pieces of analysis that Sally did for us, was to look at kind of length of effect. And I think it's interesting, given that the conversations we've had this morning about kind of short-termism, that actually that, you know, is not always kind of true for news brands as a channel. What would you see as the, you know, obviously it's great that we've had loads of knowledge this morning, but we want to go out of here and to make a difference. What would you see as the implications for advertisers and agencies? So, you know, everybody here going back to their day jobs, what should they do differently as a result? Don't mind. Marie, do you want to start?
A random one, which is not in the room, actually, and so maybe, I don't know if we can debate it, but particularly when Peter was presenting, I was thinking of IPA papers and thinking of creativity and the role of creativity in all of this. Because if you looked at IPA papers from 10 years ago, there was amazing use of print, with Mercedes doing full-page ads and Timberland and the Boddington's campaign. I was trying to remember those. And when Waitrose launched Waitrose Essential in 2008. And I wonder now, are we lacking that quality of creativity and clients allowing creative teams to think across all channels about really rich creative development that can result in multimedia campaigns? Whereas now, if Waitrose Essential wanted to get a quick campaign out this week to tell us all about their new brand, I suspect they'd go to digital really rather rapidly, rather than out of home and print, which they did 10 years ago. So I think one of the things we need to think about is how we bring the creative element into this, and clients.
I think something that struck me and that particularly came up in some of the questions to Sally was digging more into news brands as digital channels or digital inventory in their own right. And I think it's come through in a lot of this that there's some exploratory work being done on this. It sounds like we're kind of digging into it more. It's really interesting, particularly as we're starting to talk to clients a lot about understanding that programmatic doesn't necessarily mean out of context. Programmatic is a way of buying media rather than a way of throwing your hands up and saying, context doesn't matter, it's all about the audience, and if I can reach you with cake advertising on car websites, that's absolutely fine. Which it kind of necessarily isn't, and there's a kind of growing body of evidence that, of course, the context matters, and it matters for short-term effects and long-term effects. So I think as the way we think about programmatic and about digital display matures, so it's important to get that voice back in the room that says, actually, news brands offer context. They offer the opportunity to be part of a story. They offer greater kind of contextual relevance, whether you're buying them programmatically or on an insertion order. It doesn't matter, but kind of understanding the importance of news brands and the news context to digital effectiveness is going to be important.
I think that's one of the things that Peter was saying, you know, not all digital, you know, sort of channels are born equal, and, you know, trading like pork bellies. I did have to have a hunt of what trading pork bellies meant, but apparently it was a commodity. It's a commodity. And there's a famous trading place, the Eddie Murphy film of a very long time ago. There's a great piece on it, which you can all go and watch afterwards. I think that's true. You know, and we've done a lot of work in terms of context at Newsworks, and I think this sort of provides the kind of the business evidence, really, of the importance of context. Sorry, Grace, I interrupted you answering the question.
That's okay. I think what I would take away from it for the practical implications is going back to a principle that we should be doing anyway, which is thinking very carefully about what we expect each media channel to achieve. So, for example, I've seen some really interesting digital work recently where the brand was taking an ethical point of view, and they realised that it may look to some consumers as if they were playing lip service to that point of view. And so they had a good presence online so that people that were Googling it to check up on it would find the right things. And that for them was brilliant. Digital was the right medium there. But there's clearly a role for news brands, which is a lovely kind of, you know, we have great partisan newspapers that people feel very strongly about in this country. I feel like The Guardian represents me, or the FT in my case, don't judge. So there's an opportunity there for people who, you know, people are in a context when they're reading those newspapers where they might be willing to have their minds changed. And so it's just really thinking about kind of what the right medium is and what you expect it to do for your brand and your campaign.
I mean, it's the pendulum has, we believe, swung too far. How do we, you know, what are the obstacles to overcoming that kind of exodus, if you like, from print, in print news brands in particular, and how could we overcome them? Grace, do you want to?
One thing, as an econometrician, I'm probably always going to say this, but measurement, I think, is really important. You agreed, yeah? in that, you know, we have such great measures of online, but, you know, sometimes it's more difficult to get the right measures in terms of, you know, actual amount of dwell time spent with a piece of copy. Is it actually a real set of eyes or a computer looking at that online ad? And those issues of measurement need to be resolved for us to, you know, be really clear and to make the right decisions on budget allocation.
I think the opposite, the other end of the same spectrum is proof. So when you're trying to sell something to a client, particularly something that they have been drifting away from over the years, I was so thrilled to see Sally's evidence. And, you know, it's always brilliant to see Peter's, but, you know, 500 econometric models and the long and short of it and IPA database analysis. proof that you can go to a client and say, I know I'm asking you to make a shift in your budget, I know I'm asking you to commit millions of pounds to something, but there is an evidence base to my case. So I think at the very beginning, when you're when you don't have the client's own measurement, it's brilliant today to feel like, I feel like I'm leaving here with a bit more evidence than we've had before. And I think that's really helpful.
It's hard to add much to knowledge and proof, but from a media agency point of view, we've heard a lot today about the idea of kind of digital propaganda and the idea that the big digital platforms go around making a lot of noise about their effectiveness, which is true, but they also invest very heavily in proving effectiveness. Mm-hmm. So they are, the big digital platforms are among the biggest spenders on things like brand lift studies. They do invest a lot in econometrics. They are investing money and putting kind of cash behind proving to clients on individual bases, as well as giving kind of benchmarks and norms for the fact that this stuff works, which has helped make the shift towards it. Mm-hmm. Now, if you want to make the shift back, there needs to be an equal commitment to that kind of investment. What I talked about up front about agencies and publishers becoming knowledge businesses is this expectation that you will bring knowledge and proof with you. And so there needs to be a commitment there if you want to start to wrestle money back, particularly away from digital.
One more question before I sort of throw it out to see if the audience have any questions. We've talked a lot about kind of short-termism this morning. How can we, and you talked about it, Alex, a bit in your talk, how can we overcome the kind of short-term, instant, I need things yesterday kind of approach to measurement? How can we persuade people that actually longer-term things are still important and worth waiting for?
I think it's going to sound strange, but an important part of it is by not insulting your clients. There's
it's always good not to.
Yeah, it's always good, isn't it? You know, it's very easy for those of us who work in effectiveness to go, well, of course you shouldn't just think short term. Of course you're dumb if you do, and to kind of trot out statistics about the average term in office of a CMO or something like that. Actually, it's important to understand that context rather than just kind of every time you go into a room fighting against it and saying you shouldn't be thinking so short term, because you know, in the end, you'll get a negative reaction, to put it politely. I think being able to bring a combination of short-term analytical excellence and long-term knowledge is important, because you can then keep being useful and of assistance to your clients in a context where all of the demands on them are short-term. It's not like most of your clients, most advertisers are not sitting there with the luxury of loads of time and just deciding to wind you up by asking you short-term questions. It's because they're being asked the same questions themselves. Mm-hmm. And so you can keep being of useful support and keep being valuable in the short term whilst encouraging clients to keep looking over the horizon through leading indicators where you've got them, models where you've got them, and where you haven't through knowledge and through points like the ones today.
Mm-hmm. I think just building on that, I don't think what anybody is saying that it's 100% shift anywhere, take all your money out of here and put it into print. So I think we're generally working in the world of mixed media campaigns. So I think, I'm agreeing violently with you that it's to help clients understand that they will have lots of short-term data coming in, but if you have a well-constructed campaign, you'll be getting long-term effect as well as short-term effect. So, it's helping them understand that you're not asking them to walk away from something, but just shift the balance so that you're doing both jobs at the same time. It's not neither or. Mm.
A slightly different tack to the question, but I'm hoping that for the future the technology will help us with this. There must be a big data kind of answer to understanding within the campaign what's likely the long-term effect of it. And you mentioned about leading indicators, and we already probably in the room know what some of those leading indicators are. Are we shifting things like market share, which is a longer-term measure? Are we shifting things like brand consideration or emotional responses to the brand, which we usually see in tracking? I think there's a future where we'll be able to see those within campaign rather than having to wait until Millward Brown have gone off and done 100 interviews, online panels where we can see it straight away. That's where I want to go.
And I suppose being able to shut certain short-term measurement routes down as well. Because otherwise it's very easy to be like a kid in a sweet shop, and I think we need to be able to tell clients with reasonable certainty which metrics are worth focusing on, but also by extension which ones aren't, because otherwise they'll keep popping up and Facebook likes will keep kind of popping back up like whack-a-mole to kind of to come and get you.
To add one point on that, The other thing that we quite often forget about is human beings on the far end of our campaigns. So actually, human beings don't always respond on the day or in the minute and in the hour that you put out there. So even, I agree with you, it would be lovely, but even when technology allows that, our job is not to measure instant response, because every response to a campaign is not instant. And human beings have deeply rooted types of behaviour. I was really struck when I came in here this morning by everybody using paper and pen. I'm sure 100% of people in this room have a smartphone and a laptop or an iPad probably with them, but actually people are writing with pen and paper because you put it in front of them. And we have to remember that human beings haven't all transferred all their behaviours to only responding to digital responses. They take time to think stuff over about brands and purchases. Mm-hmm. So I don't think we'll ever get there, and we have to also talk to clients about that as well.
Okay, I think we've got time for maybe a couple of comments or questions from the audience. So if anybody has any burning things they want to ask or say. I know we've sort of thrown a lot at you this morning. I appreciate that. So you're probably all a bit kind of, oh. No?
Question.
Peter's got something to say. Great.
I just wanted to make a build on some great points, which is that I think we may be placing an unfair burden on marketers to solve these issues of short-termism and kind of budget allocation. A lot of the impetus behind the growth of digital has actually been at the chief exec level. The big players are going into chief execs and playing the teenage daughter routine on them. And these are often middle-aged blokes, my age, older maybe, who have a kind of sense of insecurity about being out of touch with the modern world. And they are sitting ducks for a sell that says, look, your teenage daughter is the future here. And I think if you're going to take that on, you've got to raise the game to the same level. You've got to take chief exec level data to chief execs, and you've got to confront the hype machine that's out there at the moment, because it's extremely sophisticated and extremely well ingrained. And it's going to take a lot of evidence, as you absolutely rightly point out, and a lot of studies. And it probably needs to be done on a global level. So it's all very well us sitting here in the UK saying we've got great evidence to show that, you know, legacy media or whatever have a role in the future. But these clients are often thinking on a global scale, and so these digital players are able to offer them global platforms as well. So, you know, you need to unite with your counterparts around the globe on this as well, and you need to put a consistent point of view. Personal rant of mine.
Thank you.